This is Terror House Radio with Matt Forney and Bryden Proctor.
Yeah, welcome to Terror House Radio, episode number 60. I'm Matt Forney, your charming and loquacious host, the founder and editor-in-chief of Terror House Press. Joining me is my co-host and occasional producer, the world's only comedian, Bryden Proctor.
Hey, buddy. What's going on?
I'm doing well. I woke up about an hour and a half ago, paid my rent, sucking on some...
What are you, a girl from Brooklyn? What do you mean you woke up an hour and a half ago and paid your rent?
Tuesday's my day off, so I sleep in.
All right. Well, I was up. 7 a.m., Matt. 7 a.m. I'm up. I'm you know, jogging because I'm athletic in my jogging suit. You know, I'm out there waving to babes, dude. We're on our way over there. I went to the store and bought some beer.
I'm up at 6:30 a.m. like the other 6 days of the week, but this is my day. This is my day where I just sit around and do the same things I ordinarily do, except I don't get paid for them. Oh, speaking, nice shirt, man. Where'd you get it?
Yeah. Good old Terror House shirt. I got a quick review of the shirt. Overall, pretty good. Breathes well. If you've ever bought shirts online, it comes with that weird Chinese shirt smell. But you can wash that out. And they run a little small, or I'm just getting fatter. But overall, pretty good. Came really fucking fast. Like, it came like 4 days later.
That's a shock. I mean, you know, we've had... everything's had fulfillment issues because of you know what. So when we launched because like a year ago, it was taking like a month to ship these things out. Man, you got yours in 4 days. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it came real quick. It's a good shirt.
It's very flattering on your figure.
Yeah, it's great. You can see my big old tummy. I should have gotten a large. This is a medium, but I don't know. Maybe my fat gut will stretch it out or something, but... You know, it's a good shirt. I'll have it for years. I'll be able to, like, pull it out of my closet on a lazy day and be like, oh, yeah, I hate this guy now. We were friends for years. I remember, Matt. Now we aren't friends anymore.
You can go wear it when you go commit crimes.
Yeah. I'll get one of those baby, you know, those baby Halloween masks. I'll draw a goatee on it and I'll wear this shirt and run around and go, bucks, bucks, as I rob a bank. It'll be great.
Yeah,
you've been hit by telling the Matt Forney gang and the Terror House crew were here. Pow-pow!
Are you named Terror House because you strike terror into the hearts of the population?
No, some gay shit about some museum in Italy. Pow-pow! Pow-pow!
Yes, and if you want your own very own Terror House shirt or hoodie or coffee mug or whatever, go to terrorhousepress.com and click on the merch button. It's all there. They were on sale last week. You missed that.
I did not. That's the only reason I bought one. I was out there with my big old nose going, is there a deal? Is there a deal I smell? And, you know, maybe if you're nice to Matt, they'll be on sale again, you know, but you got to remember DM pictures of your dick to Matt.
Yes.
On every platform. And maybe he'll bring 15%. Back so you can get a nice shirt.
I think the dick discount is 6.9% off.
No, but every fucking shirt I've bought from like anybody, like the weekly sweatshirt, same thing. It must just be that's how the ink or something smells. But you know that weird chemical smell on shirts that you buy from the fucking internet?
Yeah. You know, it's like
what is that?
It's whatever they do, I guess, to like, you know, print them quickly, you know, because it's et cetera. So like, I don't know.
It washes out. I mean, I've dealt with it before, but I can't pretend I wasn't disappointed, you know, cause it's like, oh, I can't wear this yet. And then I had to do my laundry, you know, I hate doing that. So it was fine. You know, just a minor inconvenience, I suppose. Matt.
You act like it's my fault.
It might be. It might as well be. You're the only one here.
By the way, you know, to everyone who gets, you know, these shirts are printed in the U.S. of A. So
okay.
You're supporting an American business.
Yeah, I think it's a comfortable shirt. You know, came with some bed bugs, but other than that, great shirt, dude. Great shirt.
Well, I mean, I'm not a miracle worker.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm too fat, so I'm like, man, I wish the terror thing was up here, but then it would look weird. but like, you know, my fat gut, it's appropriate that my fat beer gut has the word house on it, because that's where the whole shit house is, and it's just grows every day, and I will be a fat person.
Have you considered, I don't know, losing weight?
Yeah, I consider it all the time. just that follow through that, you know, it's the hard part. Consider it every morning.
Yes, considering. Speaking of which, if you want to consider asking us a question or a comment and support the show, streamlabs.com/TerrorHouseMagazine. We will read your comments and suggestions later in the program. Onward and upward. Brian, you wanted to talk about in the Heights or something, or
yeah, I mean, God.
I'm vaguely aware of this. Fill me in.
Okay, so In the Heights is this new Lin-Manuel Miranda. What is it? Whatever, the guy who did
Lin-Manuel Hamilton, right? Miranda Hamilton.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. This guy that, you know.
He also guest starred in the season 6 opener of House.
Okay, well, I didn't know that. Good for him. I'm not so caught up on his career. All I know is the fucking Alexander Hamilton thing. Can't name a single song from that. But there's apparently a musical called In the Heights, and it was obviously moderately successful or whatever. Really, I have no idea. But they made it into a movie, and it's like it's all, you know, Washington Heights. The trailer is ridiculous. But it's got, you know, all Puerto Ricans in it and shit. And 4 or 5 different critics for, you know, these different bullshit websites. The one that I've got pulled up now is The Independent. In the Heights, why the film's lack of dark-skinned black people looks a lot like colorism. And this was a take that several of these journalists had. And if you're not familiar with what colorism is, it's, I guess, like treating darker-skinned people worse if you're already a not white person. And I'm not sure why they would have to have a problem with everything like this, but I'm extremely happy that they do, because this whole movie is supposed to be some musical about Puerto Ricans and shit, but they weren't Afro-Latino, so it's already got problems with it. And I mean, there shouldn't be a problem, but I wasn't going to watch the movie anyway. But it's just one of those things, like the Rapinoe thing recently is like in that same vein of just, I'm not going to come to defend
people looking for problems.
Yeah. Yeah. Going out of their way. I'm trying to find the line in here that I thought was so fucking funny, but whatever. I guess I just can't find it.
I mean, the term colorism, I've only ever heard of it in context to Russia. So I'm guessing it's some kind of like, it's basically like racism, but they can't say race because Latinos are supposed to be one race or something. I don't know. I can't wrap my head around it.
It's just one more thing to problematize. You know, it's just that postmodern crap. But here it is. Okay. Felice Leone, an Afro-Cuban video producer for African-American-oriented outlet The Root, became one of the louder voices in this conversation a fortnight ago. She asked director John M. Chu, where are the leading dark-skinned Afro-Latinx folks? The video interview, which gained over 2 million views, is painful to watch. Chu stumbles over his words and says, in the end, you know, when we were looking at the cast, we tried to get people who were best for those roles. It's strange, isn't it, that the best person for the job always happens to look a certain way? It's almost as if it's an age-old excuse that employers have used to justify unconscious bias and racist hiring practices. I may be wrong about this, but I'm pretty sure the majority of the cast in the movie are like musical people. I'm sure that there's a few Afro-Latino or Latinx, I guess, musical people.
Latinx.
But I don't know. I mean, there really wasn't too much more to it besides I just think that it's fucking hilarious. I don't know how they can make a movie that's, and this is that Lin-Manuel Miranda guy, the guy that they all loved for Hamilton, for it was like Alexander Hamilton's a black guy or whatever. And then now they're like, no, there's not enough in this Puerto Rican movie. There's not the people aren't dark enough. I don't know how you win. And like, I don't care. And nothing bad is good. People are still going to watch this fucking movie. I mean, that Lin-Manuel Miranda guy is going to have a fucking blockbuster career for up until, you know, he like rapes somebody or something like that. I don't know. It would probably take a lot to, you know, do something bad for him. But,
well, yeah, I mean, the whole point with the musical thing is like, okay, the number of like actors, like stage actors. I mean, I know it's a movie, but, you know, musicals, yeah. You know, they call musical performers from like the stage. The number of dramatic actors in that sense is very small. How many Afro-Latinos are going into drama school to become musical actors? Very few number. Very, very, very small number.
Well, you would think. Well, I mean, I think they maybe play drums in the, you know, in the band for the for the thing, or the bass. But I want to know what would finally make these people happy. That's what I want to know, is because I want to see it. Like, it would be like a fucking train wreck. I want to know what would actually make them happy. What is the perfect thing for them? Because there's always going to be something. There's too many people that feel that they, you know, their opinion fucking matters. But it was like four different articles came out at the same time with this same, you know, it's colorism, colorism, colorism. It's hard to say that wasn't like they're not all in the same group chat going, fuck, what are we going to write about? What's trending right now? In the Heights, people seem to like that. Oh, not enough black people in it. Got it. Okay, let's get to writing, ladies. I want to know what would be their perfect fucking movie. I'm sure it would just look goddamn awful. I'd love to see it.
There was like a similar controversy about a couple years back in Hungary, where the National Opera put on a performance of Porgy and Bess. And Porgy and Bess, like, it's supposed to be performed with African American actors. Like, that's part of the licensing deal. But the National Opera just went instead, like, look, it's Hungary. There are no black musical actors here.
So they did blackface? Can understand why they might be a little mad. Good rock. I don't know. I mean, what would their perfect fucking movie look like? Just a bunch of like trans BIPOCs in wheelchairs,
yeah.
Like,
I mean, you
missing
gotta...
an eye, and then the whole story is about consent, and they like the white man consents to being hanged or something. Like, I don't know. I don't know what it would be. I'd love to see it though. Fuck.
trans man in a wheelchair. I consent to let you fondle my limp neocock.
For at 3.5 hours, and then there's applause breaks in the middle, and then for whatever reason, it's brave and funny, and it's a comedy for whatever reason, but not for the reasons that you're laughing at it. You know, it's a fucking I just don't understand. I don't understand, because I thought, what a gay fucking movie. If you watch the trailer, it's just stupid as fuck. But I thought, okay, fine, they like this stuff. I should have known. Was there any controversy with among the left with the Hamilton play? I don't think there was, because the whole point was like, if I remember correctly, like Thomas Jefferson is a black guy, and
they were all
Alexander
black,
Hamilton black. Is a black guy.
They were all black or Latino.
So they loved that, but I've never been to Washington Heights. I've never been. Don't want to go. Don't see the point in it. Don't care.
Where is it? Is that in New York City?
New York, yeah.
Yeah.
In the Heights.
Oh, right, in the Bronx.
In the Heights.
Nobody goes to the Bronx if they can help it.
I don't know. I wouldn't go to New York because why? I like being HIV negative, you know? Get a sandwich, you got fucking AIDS, man. I'm not going to be like, oh, pizza! Like, I don't give a shit about your fucking pizza. You keep your A's in your pizza and, you know, your Washington Heights. But I guess there are black Puerto Ricans and shit, right?
The Fed who runs the Proud Boys is like Afro Puerto Rican, right?
I don't know. Enrique Tarrio? Yeah, I don't know. He's some type of.
It's like he's either Afro Puerto Rican or Afro Cuban. I can't remember which.
Why put Afro in front of it? Like, it just makes me think, like, ah, funny hair. I don't understand all of this stuff, man. I wish we could just go back to the fucking 90s where it was like, you know, be colorblind and da-da-da-da. Mad TV was on, and then, you know, we are the world. And it was just like, you better recycle. And it was a different level of propaganda being just thrown at us every fucking day. Because as a kid, I was like, yeah, that's good. Let's recycle. We are the world. We are children. You know, I'm starting with the man in the mirror. Like, oh, let's make the world a better place. All right, 90s, fucking Captain Planet. Now, I like, you turn on Nick Jr. and it's like, if you're not gay, you're bad. Ha, ha, ha. If you're not gay, you're bad. Ha, ha, ha.
I mean, you saw the Blue's Clues thing, right?
Yeah.
Horrible out of tune rendition of The Saints Go Marching Home or whatever it was, but it's all about a gay pride parade.
Yeah, and it's got the fist thing in it. You see also, that?
Yeah, I saw the fist. Mm-hmm. And is it just me or has the animation quality gone down? I mean, I wasn't an aficionado of Blue's Clues because, you know, by the time that show came on, you know, I had moved on to, you know, more adult entertainment like Mighty Morphin Power Rangers.
Like porn.
But that's that show is barely animated. There's like two moving things on screen. It looks like shit, like it was drawn like an 8-year-old.
Well, because they do everything on the damn computers now instead of like hand drawing shit. So I think that probably has something to do with it. Yeah, it's all just a lower quality, more aggressive version of like all entertainment seems like really late Pink Floyd, you know, where it's just Roger Waters being 70 going, I made the wall. And like that's all entertainment seems to be just a worse version of when I was a fucking kid, except now it's like now it's Afro Latinx and gay, I guess.
Afro the Twinks.
The Twinks. Alright. So that's what that's like a twink.
A Latino twink.
Okay. Alright.
That's what I should have titled this in retrospect, this episode.
Well, I mean, in Living Color, that was a good show. You know. Homie the Clown. He was on in Living Color.
Oh yeah, yeah.
They had the Fly Girls. Those girls were so fly.
I mean, I will say with my experience of living in Mexico for the past 6 months, the colorism thing, if you want to use that term, is real. Like,
sure.
I mean, everyone knows the fucking stereotype. You turn on like a Mexican telenovela, every single actress is like white and blonde, you know?
Yeah.
Like white people have high status here. And the easiest way to increase your status if you're not white is you have to marry someone that you are white. A stereotype, like a brown, like Mexican guy gets rich. The first thing he does is he gets a white girlfriend. So they're not entirely wrong.
How is that any different than any professional sports player here in America? Like, that's the first thing they do. I mean, that's why I hate all the complaining with like the sports crap and the kneeling and all that. It's like, dude, just shut up. You play a child's game and you get all of the white women that you want. Just shut up. Play the goddamn child's game. I mean, I'm sure the colorism crap is real or whatever, but not in any way. Like, just watch the fucking movie. Be happy. It's like, there's not a single white guy in that movie, I'm sure. I thought that's what you guys wanted.
No, they're not dark enough.
We got to get Noob Saibot in here and cast him as leading role.
Not a single straight white guy, at least.
Well, is Lin-Manuel Miranda gay? He seems
He is gay, yes. Is he? Gay.
Okay. I mean, he's like a musical guy, you know, but he kind of seems like the type of guy that, like, you'd be like, oh, he's gay. And then you find out that he's not. You know, like Chris Hayes or Brian Stelter, you're like, gotta be a gay guy, right? No, they're not.
So. Nah, there's like this whole subculture of like minority gay, you know, screenwriters now. Like the guy who wrote Moonlight.
Oh yeah, I didn't see that either.
It's terrible. But yeah, that guy's gayer than a $3 bill.
You know who's not gay and makes really good black people movies?
Tyler Perry.
Tyler motherfucking Perry, bitch. You gotta watch those Madea movies.
Are you sure he's not gay?
Listen, he's so comfortable with his fucking sexuality, and he's a Christian. But he dresses up as Madea. Nothing straight. If Steven Crowder's taught me anything, there's nothing straighter than dressing up like a lady.
Yeah, it's the straightest thing you can do.
That's true. Well, it used to be, because you'd be like, oh, isn't this silly? And now it's like, I actually can't fire this person now. My business will go under.
But yeah, I mean, I'm suspicious of him just because of that. And also because, you remember Precious? The guy who wrote that was gay.
Oh, I thought that... What? I thought that that was written by a woman?
No, no, it was written by a guy. A gay guy.
I was also under the impression that Precious was based on a true story. I've never seen it.
Oh, no, no, no. The official subtitle of the movie, which has to be put in every single instance based of the movie being written, based on the novel Push by Sapphire.
Yeah, I assume Sapphire was a black woman. Excuse me.
I mean, the novel, I mean, Sapphire may be a black woman, but the movie itself was written by a gay guy.
Ah, well. So it's patriarchy at it again.
That movie is fucking hilarious, by the way.
It's just about a fat black bitch?
It's about a black bitch. It's so ridiculous, over the top camp. Like, okay, here's an example. When she gets the main character gets raped by her father and sure. She gets pregnant, she names the kid Mongo.
I've got to watch this. Oh no. Oh no, dude. That's good.
That's just one example. I mean, I think they were just deliberately trying to make a campy movie possible and just dress it up in like all this artsy crap. That dude was smiling going to the bank. He knew what he got away with.
There's some things that I'm like, how did I not write this? You know, like that Black Mirror episode, you know, when it's like gay dudes in the virtual reality fighting game that bang each other. There was I watched that laughing my ass off. It's one of my favorite pieces of fucking TV ever. It's so fucking funny, especially for the line, "Man, I fucked a panda and I still couldn't get you out of my head." I mean, I was watching this and I'm like, how the fuck did I not write this? How is this the thing that made it to TV? And I'm sure what makes it stupid is I'm sure somebody was sincere in writing this and going, wow, what a good love story. And no, it's just hilarious. But I don't know. Don't try to tell me Brokeback Mountain's not a comedy. You know, when he spits in his hand and rapes that guy, that's hilarious.
I've actually never seen that.
It's pretty funny. It won so many fucking awards. Cowboys.
That seems to be the pattern here. Like, you can make a ridiculous, like, stereotype written movie, but as long as you dress it up in, like, some woke thing, you'll get away with it. Like, you know, another example I can think of is Django Unchained.
Yeah, I still haven't seen that, but that's...
It's not bad. It's not... Well, I'm not a huge fan of Tarantino in the first place. It's not his best work, but it's okay. But basically, the whole premise of that movie is basically Tarantino just likes to see ultraviolence on screen. But he picked woke settings so that he could get away with it. You know, I mean, if you've seen Inglourious Basterds, like the most amount of screen time in that movie is given to like the Nazi who's obsessed with movies. You know, he gets like a fucking huge spiel at the beginning and the end and all that. And like in Django Unchained, the most amount of screen time is given to the white slave owner. And the whole messaging of the movie is like, you know, it's not some like, there's actually a scene where fucking Django was, you know, at the end where he's, you know, breasted and sold back into slavery. He frees himself, but he leaves the other slaves to die because, like, he doesn't care about them. They don't have the will, the power, you know, like he does. There's like a weird Nietzschean thing going on throughout the movie, too.
Tarantino's a weird guy. I mean, he's got all of these movies and whatnot where he gets to say slurs all the time, which is pretty fucking awesome, I gotta say. It's the... I don't know, the pedophilia accusations that make me a little worried about
now him with the
Tarantino.
Feet, right?
Yeah. Which, like, listen, you want to be in the feet? Be in the feet, my man. I don't give a shit. But they got to be grown-up feet. Grown-up feet. That's it. Adult feet. That's the only
better,
thing.
You better see hair on those feet.
Yeah. I mean, it's got to be.
Unless the person has diabetes.
Yeah, or alopecia. or going through leukemia. And you know what? The only exception, the only time that Tarantino is allowed to suck on a child's feet is if it's part of some cancer kid Make-A-Wish Foundation situation. I would really hope that they wouldn't sponsor that. But listen, the kid's dying. He's a weirdo. He wants Tarantino to suck on his feet. Maybe. But that's the only time, Tarantino. The rest of the time, just make movies and say the N-word. But don't don't suck kid toes, dude. It's I don't know what you're up to. I don't know. And again, these are all just rumors. You know, I can't know for sure. I like to pretend that that's not the case, but I don't. It's Hollywood, man.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah. Tarantino's an odd guy. I mean, I will give him credit. I mean, he's much better than his fucking imitators. You ever seen Boondock Saints?
I love that movie when I was a kid.
That movie's fucking terrible.
It's really bad, dude. But when you're a kid, you're like, this fucking rules. Like that and like Bloodsport, the Mortal Kombat movies. You know, I haven't seen the new one, but the original like two Mortal Kombat movies, dude, when you're a little boy, you're like, this fucking rules.
I don't think I've seen the original Mortal Kombat, but I watched the sequel, Annihilation, when I was flying from Istanbul. That movie was fucking hilarious.
There's no plot.
It's just fucking fight scenes.
Yeah, that's why the movie is great, dude. What are you talking about? It's video game characters.
Well, I was saying in the sense of like, you know, like they didn't even attempt a plot to the point where like it's almost awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Well, apparently the new one is just a lot of the same crap too. But I haven't seen it. They cast like all Asians in that, which seemed pretty fair to me. I mean, why would ninjas be white guys? But like they are white guys in the first movie and the original movies. So I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Also, you know, what's his face? Raiden or Ryden, whatever. So he dies in like 2 seconds in the sequel.
Oh yeah, Raiden did die. I know they killed Johnny Cage right at the beginning of the second one. And then he was zombie Johnny Cage in like the 64 game. That was pretty cool. Oh no, it was zombie Liu Kang. Yeah, I forget. Whatever. I don't know. It's old. Yeah, that's all I had on that, really. Entertainment sucks.
I mean, it held my attention on a 10-hour flight, you know. In contrast, I fell asleep watching Blade Runner 2049.
Yeah, I still haven't watched that shit.
It's not bad. It's not as great as everyone was saying, but it's not bad. I will defend that opinion to the death, because the weebs will get fucking mad if I say about that.
Oh, well, anybody who watches anime is a fucking pedophile, so I don't give a shit what pedophiles say about shit. They are, dude. Like, stop watching anime or, you know, you're going to start dressing like an anime girl. It's just that's the way that it is. And don't tell me how based Berserker or whatever that Goblin Slayer, one of those dumb things is. I don't care about your car. Stop watching the goddamn cartoons. Unless it's like King of the Hill is a really good cartoon. Futurama,
Rick and Morty.
I don't like their fan base at all.
I don't like their fan base either. But you know, new season started. The new first episode of the new season isn't bad.
My buddy watches that shit, and he was like, "Oh, the new Rick and Morty is good." I'm like, "Ah, I haven't seen anything since season two, but okay." I like Dan Harmon because I like Community, and Harmontown was a pretty funny podcast. But. And he wrote some cool stuff with Sarah Silverman on the Sarah Silverman program. She does blackface in that show. It's pretty funny. But I don't care about, you know, it's like, oh, look, Rick is my avatar as Dan Harmon, and I'm going to make some fucking deep points. And then the whole nerds on the internet are like, oh, I'm just like him. And it's like, just because you drink a bottle of wine every night and, you know, annoy all your fucking friends and are a dick to your family doesn't mean that you're like a smart person, you know, just because you think you're above everything. It's just, I don't know. Whatever. This is whatever people want to do. I don't give a shit.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, you know, first episode of the new season's not bad. You know, I mean, the show obviously peaked in season two, but it's decent enough that, you know, it's worth my time.
Didn't they like bring in a whole bunch of female writers? And
for season three. That's why season three was so shit.
Oh, it's still funny to me that women still think that they can like write or do anything like meaningful. I mean,
they can't even cook, which is one of the things they're supposed to be good for.
Yeah. I mean, and it's like, I know how to operate a washing machine. So, you know, I don't know. I just keep Erica around because it's like, somebody to talk at, I guess. Not talk to, talk at. You know, I get drunk, I finish my streams, And then I just go and talk at her and just drink. And I'm like, you know why the world's fucked up? That's the way that it is.
Yeah, somebody to lecture to.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I could just, if she wasn't here, I might, you know, actually like write it down or something and, you know, try to create something. But instead, I just get drunk and endlessly talk to my girlfriend and she sits on her phone going, I'm not listening to that shit. But it's fine. It's a good, normal relationship.
I figured you'd like just talk to the walls or something. You seem like a guy who talked to the walls.
Oh, I talk to myself all the time. I will wander around. So like there's a loop between like the living room and the kitchen, right? And I'll walk around thinking, drinking beers. It dawned on me the other day though, I'm like, oh, this is what crazy people do. I might be kind of losing it. But you know, what are you going to do? I'm getting my steps in, Matt. I'm getting my steps in. I'm thinking a lot. That's
what happens when you work from home. You know, office cooler talk consists of you yelling the N-word at your big screen TV while you pace in the living room.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I should like go outside sometimes. But
that is a thing I do, by the way.
What, yell the N-word? Yeah, I'm well aware. Totally aware. Like I imagine by your age you've driven cars before, so yeah, you scream the N-word. So like traffic here is fucking terrible, you know, but that's any city. How many N-bombs get dropped just in a normal like daily morning commute, do you think? Like in a city of, let's just say, city of fucking, I don't know, 150,000 people. How many N-bombs do you think get dropped on morning commute?
It's about several thousand.
I would think at least like one out of 15 cars, depending. It also would depend on the racial demographics of the city. I mean, like Chicago, everybody's blasting them. You know, it's soft, but a lot of those are going to be soft A's, but the white guys are going full hard R's on that one.
Yeah, and you also have to incorporate like the Spanish equivalent. So like there's a lot of Spanish speakers who are going to be saying the Spanish version of that.
Well, I'm just thinking about even in cities, how many N-bombs I see blasted, like, you know, when I would take the bus to work, right? So, I mean, if you're in the comfort of your own car, there's got to be a lot of them. I'm doing like 3 a.m. usually. Wake up. It's the first thing I say. I really want that to be my last words. Like I'm dying of stomach cancer in my bed and I go,
now here's a question for you, Brian. What city in the US do you think has the highest number of N-bombs dropped per morning commute?
Chicago or Atlanta?
I would be thinking Atlanta.
Yeah. Yeah, there's
just
a lot.
There's way more black people in Atlanta. It's not going to be something like Detroit or Baltimore, just because the racial balance gets tipped too far in the other direction. Nobody will be seeing it because there's no white people around. So it's got to be have a good demographic mix. So I think it'd be Atlanta or Washington D.C. or Chicago.
Oh yeah, it's got to be Washington D.C. There's got to be a lot of that. I mean, you know, like Rand Paul's driving to, you know, the Senate, and like I'm sure he's letting him fly. Tom Cotton is in that city. Okay, there's N-bombs that are thrown around. I'm sure of it.
I'm sure Bernie Sanders is chanting it on his morning walk to Congress.
He's like, I love the. Oh man.
He's reading a paper he stole from his neighbor, and he's just saying the N-word as he, you know, thumbs through it.
Well, yeah, I mean, apparently, was it White House? He probably says a few of them on the way.
Oh yeah, White House. The guy in the all white beach club.
Yeah, I know. I love that. When he was confronted about it, he's like, we're working on it. And it's like, you're okay, fine. I mean, like, one, you're not, and I know why you're not, and that's fine. But This is the guy who calls everybody racist all the time. So it's like, nothing will happen.
Is it really shocking that a guy named Whitehouse is part of a whites only club? I mean,
no.
No, it's like how the guy named Wiener turned out to be a sex offender.
Yeah, or the guy named Forney ended up being a faggot. I mean, there's just... It's the way that it is, you know. I had to get in there before you got me. My last name's Proctor, so it's way too close to proctologist.
Yeah, you've told me about
that. It's a preemptive strike, Matt. Sorry, it was a preemptive strike. Mission accomplished.
Should have really said that with a you know, a W impression.
Well, oh, I haven't done him in a while. I don't know if I can. I don't think I can do it.
No, nobody's done him in a while, if you get my meaning.
Ah. Sex. Nice. Good one. Nailed it. You got some comedy chops on you there, man. Should give who's this this Adam Corrigan guy? He's like one of the late night shows. Did you see this fucking video with him and Ariana Grande? He's awful. He's another one of those guys where I'm like, oh, that guy's gay. Turns out he's not. He's like got a wife.
What is he? Does he follow Stephen Colbert or something?
Oh, I have no idea what channel he's on or what he does. It's just I've seen clips of his stuff. And he had some song that him and Ariana Grande did, some musical style thing. And it was like, no lockdowns anymore. And it's like supposed to be all fun. And it was confusing to me because it's like how all of this has just become like some cultural event type of thing. The last time we had one of these things was like 9/11. And that was, you know, Toby Keith, I'll put a boot in your ass. Let's go and bomb Iraq. And Uncle Sam's got your, you know, that one. And it was just like, you know, even the Sikhs weren't safe on the streets. People were mad. And the Dixie Chicks can't perform anymore. This time it just seems like way worse. You know, Parks and Rec did that reunion episode that was all on Zoom. But it's been that way since the beginning. You know, this.
I think all these fucking vaccine songs are psychic warfare.
I think you're giving them too much damn credit because they seem to be from like fucking nobody. You know, they're just, it's just some weird cultural event. And everybody's trying to capitalize on it. I mean, maybe because I've never heard of any of these people. Maybe they are fucking, you know, CIA assets or something like that. I don't know, but it's certainly the worst thing.
You sent me one of the San Francisco Gay Men's Choir.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can play that right now. I haven't watched it. Just I want my reaction to be authentic. Hold on. Let me pull that shit up. Commoditize my misery for all of you.
Oh, it's rough.
Oh, whoops. Hold on. I have to fucking stop screen.
It is it's a rough one. And you gotta remember, this is like, I don't know how many, probably 50, 100, whatever, however many there are, gay men from San Francisco. On Harvey Milk Day, giving everyone else medical advice.
Oof, yeah. Anyway, I have it up now. Let's play this. Let's play this nonsense.
Oh no. Oh boy, this is a real. Vaccinate, get rid of COVID. How many of those guys are like have AIDS? There were some older guys there. How many of them have AIDS?
I'd say at least 50%.
You know, and this is this. That's who you want medical advice from is that ragtag bunch of gentlemen.
That actually wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. I find the ones that are done by white women a lot more offensive.
Oh yeah, anything that women do is going to be worse. I mean, that's just, you know.
Let me see if I can pull up the one I was talking about. This one was really fun and bad. I saw this yesterday.
It is weird how many of them there are. You know, there's all of these damn songs. Because, I mean, it's just got to be like a trend thing, I would think. There's no way that all of these people are getting checks. Well, any more checks from the government than the rest of us have gotten over the past year and a half. But what a weird thing to latch onto. Like, I swear to God, dude, like if these people were, you know, were Germans in Hitler's Germany, these people would be out there. They'd be like, Holocaust, Holocaust, for the necessary good, Holocaust, Holocaust, find a solution. Like,
yeah, they would be. Anyway, I have the
slavery,
video up.
Slavery.
I have the video up now. Let's watch this.
Please take this remedy, make COVID a memory, and when it's time, get vaccinated, please don't decline. Get your shot and we can get concerts and sports events. The summer could be so nice. Please just get your vaccine, we're so close to our dream. Put an end to this quarantine. Really wanna end
our time.
What's
your face
morphing? Let me know, surprise. Anti-vax are spreading lies.
The administration would like you to take this vaccine. Joe Biden told you last week. If you don't, you can't celebrate the 4th of July.
With so much hesitation, we'll never get out of this mess. Screwing the nation, of course, it's the Republicans. Voters all said Biden. Now thank God we've got Biden. And now, incidentally, the cases have declined. Vaccines are a miracle from science.
What are you? Oh, God.
Everyone's compliant. A shot or two will suffice. Keep your vaccine. We're so close to our dream. Put an end to this quarantine. Guarantee that you'll be fine.
It is a safe and effective product.
Need right. Everyone's compliance. That doesn't seem like you couldn't change that lyric to sound less menacing,
less threatening. Yeah.
Yeah. Like,
well, I mean, she's
pick up that gun.
I mean, she thought Biden and Biden were a good slant rhyme. So, like, I'm not expecting much from a white woman.
Was it just me? Was it just the video? Was quality was weird or something? It looked like her face was morphing. Like, if I finally snapped, am I just gone full schizophrenic? Or
I'm thinking it was two different people. Like, the woman in the back with the clones was like a younger woman.
Maybe.
Or maybe it was some kind of computer altered thing. They definitely look different. The one in the middle is like your typical mid-30s, you know, childless barren hag who, you know, thinks Jon Stewart was so funny back in the aughts and never grew up.
But doesn't like him now that he said it came from a lab.
I don't know. I mean, I can see all these fucking idiots, you know, going for that.
No, that was a big blowback over that, at least with the fucking Journo crowd. They were like, how could Jon Stewart, you know, perpetuate a fucking conspiracy theory and all that? I don't know why they fucking love China. Well, they're probably all those media outlets probably getting kickbacks from China, but it, yeah, there was a big blow up about the whole thing. So I don't get the songs. I don't understand them all. Cause it does say, these are the same people, remember, that would be like, I would have been on the, what they call, you know, the right side of history. Why do you trust and love the government and big pharma now, but say that you wouldn't back then? Like, I don't know. Oh, my camera's all weird. There we go. Well, that didn't fix it. Oh, well, I'll just be blurry. But
Am I wrong here?
These people have always been fucking, you know, herd followers.
It's just a strange thing. I mean, not that they're like the fucking MAGA crowd are much better, because it's bizarre that they're like, oh yeah, I'm not going to take the vaccine. And it's like the vaccine was started under Trump, you know, like, why wouldn't you blame
Operation Warp Speed?
Yeah. You know, but like the other side of the thing is like, oh, well, I'm not going to give Trump any credit for that, but I love the fact they all seem a little dumb. I that's one of my least favorite things that Trump ever did, was like the lockdowns and shit like that. Never forgive the guy for that crap.
Well, he didn't do the lockdowns. State governors did.
Right, but he was all excited about it and fed into the whole COVID crap. I mean, we're going to find out, or rather the general public will find out way later what the fuck happened, and it'll be like, oh, wasn't that a weird thing that just cost people their livelihoods and a bunch of people died and shit.
Well, so you saw the propaganda articles about how, you know, the American dream of home, owning a home, is dead.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
it's not a bad thing. America should become a nation of renters.
Well, I mean, how else is BlackRock going to make any fucking profit? Oh, well, if they didn't, the government will just give them a whole bunch of money. It's...
Well, I mean, in a year, we'll see stuff like the American dream of gainful employment is dead, but we should become an economy of gig workers. That's a good thing.
Well, it will. And then, you know, then we'll just get completely deplatformed from work. I mean, I've thought for probably about a year or so that what'll happen is people will sit at home and they will, if they're lucky enough, they'll trade their own money. You know, they'll trade stocks, and everybody will try to be a day trader to push up the stock market, to push up all of these different company stock prices. And then
to keep the currency from hyperinflating.
Right. So like when you fail as a day trader, which you absolutely will, then you just go back and you work at the Amazon fulfillment center until you can save up enough money to sit at home and try to day trade again. You can't do both because, I mean, you got to live at that fulfillment center.
Yeah. You know, Jeff Bezos wouldn't take kindly to you twiddling on Robin Hood when you're supposed to be throwing boxes into trucks.
Yeah. Or peeing when you're supposed to throw boxes. Granted, I think that was only one place that had that issue, but yeah, it doesn't look good. But hey, cicadas. Tucker Carlson's eating cicadas. Juneteenth has like a whole thing now. That's good. You have a good Juneteenth.
Sorry, Terror House does not recognize any holiday passed after January 1st, 1960, as canon.
It's got a flag. It's a federal holiday.
It's non-canon, Bryden.
Seven people got shot in Portland at a celebration. I mean, you know, it's good. Just good. Average, normal things. It's nice. You know, you get a whole new holiday. Now, you won't have that day off, but the bank will be closed.
Sorry, I only recognize canon holidays like Independence Day and George Lincoln Rockwell Day.
Oh, man. George Lincoln Rockwell Day is pretty much the inverse of Juneteenth. Yeah, there's a flag. I didn't know. What other holidays have flags? Christmas doesn't have a flag, does it? It's got a tree, though. It does have a tree.
Let's see. Thanksgiving doesn't have a flag. I can think of foreign holidays that have a flag, but not any American ones. Like the Hungarian holiday celebrating the 1956 revolution, that's got a flag, where they just take the center and cut a flag and cut it out. Because, you know, when it was a revolt against the communist government, and the flag of Hungary at the time had the hammer and sickle in it, so they cut the hammer and sickle out. So they've got a flag for that holiday, but I can't think of any American ones that have a flag.
Yeah. I don't think that there is. New Year's has hats and glasses. July 4th obviously has a flag, you know. You have more themes for holidays than you do flags. But hey, at least, excuse me, geez, I guess the theme for, Juneteenth will be shootings in Oakland. So that'll be
actually, now that I think about it, Martin Luther King Jr. Day has a flag, but it, was copied from, another holiday.
Does it?
It's a joke. Because Martin Luther King was a plagiarist.
Oh, okay. I don't know. I
I didn't know. Maybe just only black holidays have flags. I don't fucking know, Matt. I'm not a fucking... I don't know. And how can Martin Luther King be a plagiarist when his speeches were written by, was it Stanley Levinson? Huh? So maybe Stanley Levinson is a plagiarist. That's the way that it is, man. But yeah, I don't know. I didn't notice any different Juneteenth things. What a dumb fucking name, too. And like, I know this is like everybody has said this before, but like people acting as if they knew about it are lying. I mean, the only people that knew about it were people from Texas. Texas has been celebrating that shit forever.
Not even the entirety of Texas. Like, a friend of mine from Texas says that Juneteenth was only celebrated in the parts of Texas which had plantation slavery, which was only like the really eastern part. Like, there's no plantation slavery going out and fucking happening in fucking El Paso. So nobody celebrated Juneteenth there.
I had never heard of it until, what was it, like last year?
Yeah, you know? Same here.
And it's the same thing with, like, you know, they did this year with the old Tulsa incident thing. And they also misrepresented that. But I turned on NPR and they acted like
6 million black men were killed in Tulsa.
Yeah, I turned on NPR and they acted like they talked about this shit every year, and it's like, but you didn't. You don't. Why is this so fuzzy? This is so annoying to me. Look at my thumb. I mean,
your thumb looks diabetic.
What? It does not.
It's all red and stuff.
No, that's the lighting. It is a little red. Fuck, I got diabetes. Why are my hands so red?
I'd ask you to show me my feet, your feet for a more effective diagnosis, but I don't want to see your fucking feet.
Quentin Tarantino could be watching though.
Shit.
Yeah.
I think he's straight. I think he's into chicks.
I don't know. I don't know him that well. A friend of mine saw him at a restaurant eating soup once though, and took a picture of him, and I thought that's weird and funny. Just take a picture of a guy eating soup.
Nothing weird about that at all.
Yeah. Do Terror House News. I'm going to go take a piss.
All right. And the news is next week, our next book will be out. It'll be The Insurrectionist by Andy Nowicki. Andy Nowicki's first new novel in 7 years. It has never been seen before. He wrote it over the course of the last year. Terror House is bringing it out. That will be out on July 2nd. The real Independence Day. Celebrate the real Independence Day with The Insurrectionist, a novel about Project Blue Beam and other things that are, shall we say, relevant to the current socio-political climate. He will also be on the show again very soon. So The Insurrectionist by Andy Nowicki, out next week. Later in July, we will be releasing Rhythm and Mucus by Mather Schneider. Mather Blather. He's always on my case for mispronouncing his name. Mather Schneider will be out later in July. I don't have a hard release date for that yet. But it's a collection of poetry, and it's pretty damn cool. You know, Mather's a cool guy. So, yeah, that's coming later in July. Rhythm and Mucus by Mather Schneider. He's also our number one fan of Terror House Radio. So
he doesn't cool like too. Me.
He doesn't like you, but he keeps listening.
He might be your fan. He doesn't like me at all.
Oh, come on. It's like it's he's doing the equivalent of yanking your pigtails on the playground.
Mm, yeah, I hate it when people yank my pigtails. That was a rough time in my life. I don't know what else is what else has happened.
Well, there was you mentioned Megan Rapo.
Oh yeah. that probably has nothing to do with the Ghislaine Maxwell Jeffrey Epstein thing at all. But Les Wexler, the owner or head of Victoria's Secret, said that he's getting rid of the Victoria's Secret angels, which I didn't know was a fucking thing. Why would I? Which I guess are just hot bitches. And instead, they're going to have Megan Rapinoe, the soccer player, like be the spokesperson and they're going to hire a bunch of fat bitches. Okay. Somebody found a tweet from 10 years ago where she was like adding somebody and said, haha, you look Asian with your eyes closed. And they're saying that's fucking racist 10 years ago. I don't know if she's made a statement or anything like that. And part of me is like, look, that's stupid and wrong to go after her for it. But the other part is like, good. You know, I don't know. That's funny. Because like, she wouldn't give a fuck about, you know, me or anybody else. And she's going to be fine. She's got plenty of money and all of that crap.
She's a hormonally imbalanced lesbian who plays soccer. Trust me, she wouldn't care about you.
No, not a chance. But I also don't see how that's fucking Asian. But the person she was adding still has an account. The account's private, no avatar, like no profile picture at all. So I can pretty much only assume that it's a white woman. But her bio now says, at whatever Megan Rapinoe's thing is a racist bitch, hashtag stop Asian hate. And like locked the account, you know, because I imagine people are coming after her or whatever. How much time and energy do you need? Like, somebody had to have just gone through all of her tweets that was like, fuck, I can't find anything. I guess I'll just search Asian. Okay, that might be. Sure, that's it. Let's make a big deal out of this.
But they just going down every single fucking search string they could think of. They started with like the N-word and this went down the scale of hatred.
Pretty much. Yeah. And that's what they landed on. But of course, several articles about that. I mean, it couldn't have happened to a stupider bitch, so I'm okay with it. But you know, you ever get that, like when things like this happen, part of me is like, I should be against this because it's wrong and it's stupid that it's happened. And then at this point, I've just gotten to the point where I'm like, ah, fuck them. I don't know. You're not going to stop this crap from happening. So at least it's happening to these assholes. Like, you know, oh, your movie is colorist. And oh, she said you look Asian 10 years ago. I don't know. I want to be guided by my principles and say that's stupid and wrong. And not that I have any type of a sway or platform or anything like that, but let's just assume that I did for some reason. I probably wouldn't fucking say anything other than that's good. I'm glad. It doesn't matter. You can say 1,000 times, because really at the end of the day, that's a stupid thing for people to be mad about, but that's the world that they created. That's the world that they are advocating for. So it's like when Jimmy Kimmel eventually gets fucking Me Too'd or some weird shit, and it'll happen because it happens to all of these guys. I'm going to be like, ah, that's kind of bullshit, but funny that it happened.
Yeah,
it's a shitty thing to have to think of. Like,
I mean, I just can't stand Megan Rapinoe because her entire she's fucking astroturfed. Okay, number one, she's a soccer player. Nobody fucking cares about soccer. She's a women's soccer player. People care even less about that shit. And number three, coincidentally, she's a pink-haired lesbian. Woo.
Well, like, aren't they good? Isn't the like women's U.S. soccer team like?
It doesn't matter how good they are. Maybe the WNBA is good too. There's a good WNBA team. Nobody watches that shit.
No, I know, but like maybe that's why it picked up. I mean, I'm sure it was just like, we need to talk about women's sports or whatever. What we need to do is let a bunch of trans women on the team, and then that'll just put her to shame. Just these dudes running around, just putting her to shame, making her look fucking stupid. Then they can be the Victoria's Secret spokesperson, just all of them, just a gang of trans women standing around in soccer jerseys, beards. You know, it'd be pretty good.
I mean, this is like remember 2 years ago, Megan Rapinoe was featured in the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue.
No,
she's fucking gross. She has man ass.
Hey, so will my proposed team. I mean, we're halfway there, dude. We're halfway there. I say at this point, let them do it. I mean, there's gonna be a trans woman weightlifting person, I think from like New Zealand or something like that, in the Olympics. And I'm thrilled. Like, that seems
super funny because it's like, that's who's going to win. That's who's going to win the gold. I mean, it's already dead set. I'd like to see what the betting markets have to say about this because it's like, that's who's going to win. There's no way that that's not who wins. We need trans women in UFC and boxing, especially. Look, I can't say it enough. Trans rights are dudes' rights. All right. And dudes rock. So it's just the way that it is. I think that's a good fucking way to do it.
We need them on the curling team. We need them on every Olympic team.
That, and you know what? Let's let female to male trans into the NFL. You know, we've got to go for equity, and let's see how good they can take a hit, huh?
Definitely. They also need to be in the NBA and the NHL.
Oh, completely. Completely, dude. Like, sports is pretty boring except for baseball. So I say we just let this happen.
Wait, did you just say baseball?
Yeah, baseball rocks.
You like baseball?
Mm-hmm.
Baseball is fucking boring, dude.
You're fucking boring, dude. That's your name, boring dude. If you were a superhero, you'd be boring, dude. I'm here to read books. That's you. Oh, did you know about poetry? I'm boring, dude.
Ooh, let's play a ball around and throw a ball around and take forever. That's baseball.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's a cerebral sport. You wouldn't understand.
Ooh, I'm thinking so hard about throwing the ball at this dude. I'm thinking so hard I can't even have a timer.
The last time we talked about sports was many episodes ago, and you declared to me that all sports was greased up naked men wrestling. So I'm not going to take your word on what is and is not a good sport because I think
I said that.
Yeah, I forget the episode, but yeah, it was a good long segment of us arguing over this. And I think it was the last time I told you I like baseball.
That must have whizzed past my head.
Yeah, much like the whiz of your boyfriend.
I don't know. I always thought you were like more of a hockey guy.
I don't understand hockey really. Like it's fine or whatever, but like I don't know what the penalties are. I don't know what icing is. Like I get it if you punch a guy in the face, penalty box. That makes sense. You can't do that. But what is icing? Would you get some ice on him or something? I don't know what it is. And hockey's long and it's just skating back and forth. It's
hockey's like so is baseball.
Yeah, but hockey is like it's two steps away from being figure skating, you know. But I was at a bar recently and I did see that there's a women's hockey league. It's on like ESPN 47 or whatever, but professional women's hockey, and man, they skate slow. Like they're just garbage. And the team was apparently so damn good. It was being interviewed for a segment on ESPN. They just skate slow. They just skate real slow. It's awful. You see the guys out there, women, it's awful. Awful. Women's sports is just bullshit. Stick to, you know, they're not even good at gymnastics. I was going to say stick to fucking gymnastics. Nope. Men are better at that too. Like, you see them like stand on one finger and shit like that. Women, they're like, meh, I'm going to bounce on a fucking pad and twirl a bunch. Women are just not great at sports. I don't know. What are they? Okay, we got to figure this out. They got to be good at something, right? I mean, if you believe in God, you would have to imagine he wouldn't put on this earth a totally useless creature, although the panda does exist. So it's pretty rough. It's pretty rough.
Yeah, I mean, it's not cooking. I'm a better cook than any woman. It's not really cleaning. That's pretty much easy to do if you aren't a total slob. Sex, maybe? I mean, but then again, they have a... That doesn't count. They've got a monopoly, so that doesn't count.
I don't know. You tell me. You would know who's better.
I walked into that one.
Yeah, much like you walked into that bathhouse. Yeah, I don't know. They got to be good at something, right?
Well, they wear dresses better than men. I know that because you can see it in the world now more often than you'd like.
Yep.
So there's that. Gotta start letting them play fucking, you know, gotta start letting them play sports. Damn DeSantis and your Bills ruining my bits where we just let them wrestle and shit.
Just you know, set the bits in, I don't know, New York or something.
Yeah, you're just going to have to. It's, oh, man. I don't know. Is there a trans UFC fighter?
There has to be. Fallon Fox? I think that's one.
Oh, okay. I searched trans UFC fighter, and it auto, like, completes to trans UFC fighter breaks skull.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, this is on Sports Skeeta. I don't know what that is. When transgender fighter Fallon Fox broke her opponent's skull in an MMA fight. It's this dude just... Oh, shit, dude. Yep, nope. I say that is... that's the only way that people are going to go, hold the phone. This might be not what I've been led to believe here. It's just broken skulls. All women quit UFC. They're like, fuck that. I'm done. Dana White can kiss my ass. I'm done with it. Oh, man. It just auto-completes, dude. Try it. You just trans UFC fighter. Break skull.
Let me pull it up. I'll build on a private tab too, so I can get it more accurate.
There you go.
Trans UFC. Oh shit, you're right. Well, there's two hits. There's trans UFC fighter break skull, and then there's trans UFC fighter break skull video.
Oh god, I haven't seen the video, obviously. Holy cow. I mean, it's not good. You don't want somebody to break your skull, but like, I guess women aren't even good at having, you know, as good at having skulls. Guys take those punches all the time.
Their bones are thinner, as is their skin.
As is their fucking brains, idiots. Oh.
Yeah, fewer folds. Very, very smooth.
Yeah, dog brains.
Yeah.
That's,
dog brains full of dog cum.
Yeah. Yeah, women don't do that great. Yeah. I can't really think of much. I mean, it could be worse, I guess. They could. No, it can't, because they're worse at everything and then turn around and say that they can do anything better. I'm on board with this trans women or women thing. I'm fine with that. From now on, I'm gonna be like, yeah, definitely, they should play sports against women, because it's just always funny. It's always funny, and you know that it's the asshole, because that's the only way that people are gonna see the issue here, is if they have to actually see it, and maybe there'll be a push against
it. Rub their nose in it like a dog in its own crap.
Yeah, like look at what you've done to the country. Just like, look at what you've done. You gonna do it again, huh? Well, too bad. We all the men have grown accustomed to it. We think that it's hilarious, so that's what we're doing now. From now on,
it's like same what's going on with critical race theory. By the way, I would like to announce that I officially support CRT: cocaine, rum, tobacco.
Rum is a bullshit sugary drink for children.
Boo.
Fuck rum, dude. Rum is nasty as shit.
Well, you need to drink British rum. Spanish rum, yeah, it sucks.
I don't think I've ever had British rum. That's like trying to tell me to drink Canadian whiskey. You know.
No, like, no, no. There's a real difference. Like, your British rum has very little sugar in it.
Well, I mean, I don't know. Send me some brands, or I'll try to find some brands.
Pussers. Really, Pussers is the one you want to try.
Oh, that's what you want to drink. Pussers.
Yeah, it's good. It's made using the original stills that the British Royal Navy used to make the rum rations for their sailors in the UK Virgin Islands.
No, dude. Like, no, that's a terrible pussers. That's a terrible fucking name. It's like, oh yeah, what do you want? Oh, I'll have a bile light, please. A draft.
It's named that because the pusser was the person on the ship who handed out the rum ration.
I don't know if that's a good name for that guy.
Well, they're British. What do you expect?
Well, more than pussers. I mean, that's a terrible name, dude. That's awful.
But it's a good drink.
I'll try it. I mean, let me see if I can. Was it P-U-S-S-E-R?
Yeah.
Yeah, Pusser's Rum.
You can get it pretty much anywhere in the States.
That looks fucking stupid. I don't ever want to buy anything with a goddamn British flag on it. I hate them, dude. Like, you know, Bo's a fucking Brit, but he's been on the show, right? Has Bo been on the show?
He has been on the show, yes.
Yeah, he was like really early on. Bo's a good guy. I don't like his accent. I don't like that he eats clay on toast all the time. I don't like his queen. I'm not a big.
You don't like the way he puts U in the letter U in the word color.
Yeah. What is that all about? Just leave it out, man. Come on. You know, I like the evolution of American English, though. We dropped the U from color, and now, depending on who you're talking to, we have dropped the Y and the O from U. No, it's good. I can't wait for everything to be like, you know how in Firefly, they've got, you know, like occasionally they'll use Chinese swear words and shit like that. If that movie was accurate, everybody would be speaking fucking Ebonics, and it would have made it a better show. It would have made it a way funnier show.
Yeah. I think with regards to color, it went the other way around. They added the U. We didn't subtract it.
Did they?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that they made the language up first.
Well, American English is actually closer to the original, like, English, you know, because, like, we preserve pronunciations and stuff that the British have abandoned. Like how we say garage instead of they say garage.
Garage. Aluminium. What the fuck is that? What the fuck is that? Aluminium.
And also another thing, too, the Ebonics accent, as well as, like, you know, the typical stereotypical Southern accent, was actually the accent of the royals in the 1600s. Like, that was how the Queen talked.
In Ebonics?
Yeah.
that's where Kangs and Queens comes from. Yeah, you know, because the Queen of England.
Yeah, the Lowland South was settled by Cavaliers, you know, royalists. So, like, you know, that's how they talked.
They, you know, sure. I'll believe that now. And I will go and tell people that.
Like they literally said y'all to each other, the Queen of England.
They're dropping in bombs.
I'm sure they were dropping in bombs too.
Probably. I, how many times do you think the Queen of England has said the N word in her life? At least once, right?
Once a day.
Probably. I would imagine, you know, she has to have, like, can you believe one of these is going to marry my son. That had to have happened at least once.
I'm sure when that happened, it got doubled to twice a day, and bombs.
Can you believe they went on Oprah and were like, it was bad for us. It's like, you have more money than God. You know, I don't.
They didn't even have to work to get that money. All the royals get a fucking stipend from the British Treasury.
And she was just some bitch actress that was on, like, what, Suits or something like that?
Nobody fucking heard of her before she got married to this dude.
I mean, not really. Like, she was a working actress, you know. I mean, she was on, like, a TV show or whatever. But it makes you wonder, how the hell did they meet? You know, I'm sure they have an official story and stuff, but it's probably some satanic bullshit.
Prince Harry's a cuck.
Yeah,
that's how they find him. You know, his mother died in a car crash while she was stupping some Arab dude, and that scarred him for life. So he ended up marrying a woman like his mother, narcissistic and manipulative.
I was listening.
Princess Diana was a whore. Okay, Queen Elizabeth did nothing wrong in getting rid of her.
Yeah, I was gonna say, wasn't she like killed by? I just got this great article here. This is a tweet from CC Adams, who is apparently a race journalist at NBC Black, which I did not know this was a thing. I did not know that NBC Black was a thing. But so there's this NBC News article. Black people are more likely to die in traffic accidents. COVID made it worse. She gives a little rundown here. Black people are 82% more likely to die in traffic accidents than white people. Experts say this happens for three reasons. Infrastructure decisions rooted in racism. I don't know what that means. Highways built through black neighborhoods. Drivers less likely to stop for black walkers. That can't. Nobody driving a car is like, should I run this guy over? Well, he is black. Like, that's not happening. Could it be, I don't know, black folks wandering into the goddamn street all the goddamn time?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you ever see this famous video of, like, a black dude, like, he was doing the Dougie in the street, like, just walking backwards?
Oh, yeah, he got hit by a truck.
Yeah, he got hit by a truck. And the funniest part was, like, he saw the truck, like, a split second before it hit him, but he didn't move because he expected the truck to just swerve out of the way.
Everybody who's driving a car now is on their phone. This is something that bothers me quite a bit. Everybody drives like this. They're on their phone while they're driving. So you can't expect anybody to stop for you.
Yeah. I mean, I when I was living in Albany 10 years ago, I once, you know, saw a bunch of black kids playing in a street, and this was like a major street. It wasn't like a little side street. They were just playing a ball. Car nearly runs into him. It's being driven by a black woman. She gets out and she fucking yells at them, like, what the hell are you doing in the street? You know, where's your mom, etc. You know, and then she gets in her car and drives off.
Well, I mean, kids are real dumb and they play in the street a lot, though. They shouldn't be playing in the street, but.
Well, again, you know, it was a good question. Where's their fucking mothers?
Well, I mean, you know where their dad is. but it's. So I don't know. I'm gonna have to read the article, but I want to know infrastructure decisions rooted in racism. What the fuck? Who is like, who's going, well, we have to build a highway, yeah, Sam. I don't know.
It's like the whole thing about how like highways were constructed to isolate black neighborhoods. You know, there's a big controversy about that in my hometown because there's a, you know, the main in Syracuse, the main interstate is Interstate 81. And it goes north, south through the city. And like the southern portion of it just, you know, cuts off, you know, the south side, which is mainly black, from the university district, which is white and gentrified. And people have been upset about that for years. That always fucking confused me because like I know Syracuse like the back of my hand. You know, there are crosswalks under the highway, right? You could walk to the other side. It'll take you longer than a normal, you know, street, but you can get across it in about a couple minutes.
Do you think that maybe the way the highways were built is why there were no Afro-Latinx in the Heights?
Quite possibly.
I think that we solved it.
Quite possibly. I mean, they couldn't cross the Cross Bronx Expressway.
I don't know. I mean, we're just here to solve problems, dude. That's it. Dr. Kockenstein on the fucking case. Every time I'm able to solve the problems, I know all of the issues of systemic racism and musical racism.
Dr. Kockenstein, he got his PhD from Phoenix University.
Yeah, Penis University. Man. Yeah, I don't know. I don't have any fucking clue. Every day I wake up and I go, well, shit, I'm not going to be able to do anything I ever wanted to do in life, even if I was capable of it, you know. And I guess you know, at least you get to watch. Nobody really thinks that they're going to be around for the end of the world, you know, except for like evangelicals and stuff. It's good. It'll be a fun thing to say, you know. Like, I was there when people blew themselves up, you know. The whole world just exploded. It got so gay that it turned into a prolapsed ass. Like, just
you were there when people blew themselves.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you can blow yourself, that's pretty impressive. Like, that's a pretty impressive thing to be able to do. I wish I could, but you know, my mouth is too small.
Yeah, someone else is too small too.
No, Matt. Mouth is too small.
You got a small mouth.
Fish. I wish I was a fucking fish. That'd be cool. You swim around till you die. It's kind of exactly like my life is right now, though. Just swimming around until I die. Except, you know, instead of swimming, I'm just complaining and worrying.
You're more like a beached whale. You don't really go anywhere.
Yeah, well, beached whale that can barely fit into this fucking shirt. It's the shirt's fault, not mine. Too fat. Too fat. Matt is actually trying to get a camera so that he could also do video on here. The problem is he can't find a camera with a wide angle lens, which he requires because he's so fucking fat. I don't know. You got anything else? I kind of think we're just like treading water here at this point to get back into fish, but
like a fish.
We're yeah, treading water like a fish. Because I mean, nah. I got a piss. We can keep going. I don't give a fuck. I can do 3.5 hours. I'll call Ben on my phone and we can just talk to him.
But let's end it because like I just checked the Streamlabs and no one has sent us any tips. This
of
show.
Course not. They know,
you well, fucking cheap not. Bitches. Well, we got a few the last show, so you know.
Our fucking audience is 100% Zionist, bro.
It's not, you know, sucks. But anyway, yeah, let's end the show. Brian, anything you want to plug?
Probably stream something today. But no, I mean, I don't have anything going on in my life. Just like to plug a bullet right into my head. That's about it, you know?
Wait, I just laughed at that.
Yeah, you should.
I mean,
it's going to be really funny. I'm going to do it on this show too. Like, I'm going to be like, oh, Brad, anything you want to plug? I'm going to be like, I'm glad you said something and just shoot myself. And then you're going to be forever associated with it. It's like Matt Forney, so boring that a guy shot himself.
Okay, yeah, but go check out Bryden on DLive, DLive.tv/Bryden, Trovo.live/Bryden. That's right.
Maybe
right?
More, yeah, that is right. Maybe more the Trovo than the DLive. DLive's getting real annoying, so definitely on Trovo.
And then there's this website, BrydenProctor.com. All that shit's in the description. And of course, my website is MattForty.com, and all my shit's in the description as well. That'll do it for this episode of Terror House Radio. You can check out TerrorHouseMag.com every day, Terror House Magazine. Books, TerrorHousePress.com, Terror House Press. Social media links in the description. The MP3 link will be up after the show ends. And of course, you can always find the past episodes of the show at TerrorHouseRadio.com. Terror House Radio is produced by Bryden Proctor, presented by Katja Degg. Intro music by Zero Pulse. Illegitimate non-cooperandum. Don't the bastard grind you down. I'm Matt Forney with Bryden Proctor, and we are out.